Dr. Pauline Keating, thank you very much for joining us today. How do you conceptualize democracy?
Yes, well, the hardest question first. I begin by being very bland and say the one word, freedom. After that, popular sovereignty. I define democratization as the process of empowering the people. And then there's the question of how do people exercise power. My focus is on groups, so the freedom to organize is fundamental to my definition of democracy. And groups that constitute the foundation of a democratic society have participants that are equal, that have free speech. These groups form networks. They are politically autonomous. They have institutional channels through which they can negotiate with the agents of the state. And so, in conclusion, the state-society relationship is fundamental. It's what determines how much democracy we might find in, for example, China. And the key questions are about the way in which societal groups, that is, non-government groups, cooperate with the state, negotiate with the state, bargain with the state, remonstrate with the state. Now, I have made no attempt to define a political structure that might or might not be democratic. And essentially, I leave open the question of political structures. The key issue is popular sovereignty, people power, the extent to which the people in groups can exercise decision making and have their decisions heard and debated and negotiated with other groups and then ultimately with agents of the state. That's as far as I'm going to go at this point.
Very interesting. And I see that you mentioned China. That is the central focus of our interview. But which China are we talking about? Is it mainland China, Hong Kong, Macau, Taiwan, or all the former as greater China?
Well, I'm talking exclusively about mainland China. That's not to say that the issues I explore are not relevant to the greater China, but given my definition of democracy, the structure of state power, geographic size and demography all play a critical role in determining the possibilities of democracy. And the mainland is distinctly different in those respects in terms of the structure of state power, in terms of its geographic vastness, in terms of its massive population. Those factors, the structure of state power, size and population, make democracy a bigger problem on the mainland, I suggest. And it's that bigger problem that captures my attention. So in other words, the study of Taiwan democracy, of which I've done very little, but a little, is very interesting, but it's very different because for a major reason, its smallness relative to the mainland.
In The Secret History of Democracy, the edited collection by Isakhan and Stockwell, we see that you went metaphorically digging for democracy in China. What evidence prompted you to argue that democracy could be found in ancient China?
Well, that question made me think about precisely what set me off on this. And I think I'd go all the way back to my PhD thesis, now more than 20 years old. But my focus was on the Chinese Communist Party's base area in northwest China, and particularly a focus on the cooperative movement. And what was striking in the communists' organizing of cooperatives was their use of local traditions of self-organization. And in fact, this became one of the striking features of the cooperative movement right across the communist base areas behind Japanese lines, that local officials, local mobilizers, were ordered to investigate local traditions, local history. And so in each base area, the cooperatives were given different names according to local traditions. Now, of course, that can be regarded just as a ploy, a means by which the Communist Party attempted to coerce or persuade, convince the peasants to participate in these, what ultimately became new organisations. But I think I have a middle position between the cynical view and the naive view, and see a genuine concern to root new organisations, new institutions in local traditions. My main research continues to focus on cooperatives, rural cooperatives and grassroots cooperatives, not just the communists, but the experiments undertaken by a range of rural reformers in Republican China. And that continues to be a salient feature of a cooperative movement that has any chance of success, one that is rooted in local traditions, forms that are familiar and that have been proven to work. In the area of elite politics, I was first struck, I suppose, by Paul Cohen's study of Wong Tao and his distinction between reformers of the littoral and reformers of the hinterland. Do you know what I'm referring to?
The name does strike a chord, yes.
Well, very crudely, his focus is on Wong Tao, but he depicts Wong Tao as a westernized intellectual, and because westernized did not in the late 19th century gain acceptance into elite circles and to the circles of political power. And Cohen's argument is that it required the reformers of the hinterland, the people who did have deep roots in a traditional China, it required those people to translate and accommodate the ideas that Wong Tao had imported from the West, that it required them to translate those ideas into not just a Chinese idiom, but into a vision that was based on familiar traditions, on ancient traditions, before, in fact, they became grounded. Cohen concedes that his argument only applies to the late 19th century, that by the early 20th century, westernization was rolling full steam ahead, and that the people we call the democratic reformers were unashamedly calling for a Western-style democracy. But it was that early study of the late 19th century that fascinated me, that in fact that a Western-style democracy movement could only gain traction in China by rooting itself in traditions that we can describe as Chinese.
Fascinating. And this is a perfect segue to our next question. Through Andrew Nathan's monograph, Chinese Democracy, 1986, and your work, Organizing Peasants, we see that there is something of a duality when we come to speak of democracy in China. There is the argument that democracy was planted as a seed by Western, quote-unquote, powers in early 20th century China, like you mentioned in the previous question. But that, I think, is completely deracinated by your work, for example, and the argument that democracy existed from the dawn of the Chinese state through the consolidation of Qin, a dynasty, if I'm pronouncing that correctly, and before that during the Warring States period, where the plurality of Chinese nations lived and warred together. how is it that these two arguments can exist together in the way we think of democracy in China?
I begin my article, Digging for Democracy, with what can be described as the standard story of Chinese democracy, of an idea introduced from the West in the late 19th century, and then carried forward by people who can be described as Westernizers. But that standard story, as I present it at the beginning of my article, is really overdrawn, although I'm afraid that it's a story that my students sometimes narrate in their essays. The older histories that they use without my recommending them tend to imply that nothing happened in China until the West came along and woke up the sleeping giant. So, you know, that's the fairly standard trope that is out there as a common understanding. But for decades now, historians have been emphasizing that even the most radical of China's westernizing democrats were, in fact, synthesizers. They appreciated that a new China had to be built on the foundations of old China. So I'm not arguing that there is a duality, if you like, between an ancient Chinese democracy and then a new Western democracy introduced and imposed with the arrival of the West in the 19th century. That in fact, what we see is an evolution of the Chinese indigenous traditions, and in correspondence and in conversation with Chinese traditions. And I'll try to give an example of what I mean. The local self-government tradition is critical to my focus. As I said at the beginning, I'm interested in people organizing and as grassroots organizations as the foundations of a democratic system. The local self-government movement in China has ancient roots, goes back more than 1,000 years. And Chinese reformers at different periods of Chinese history have worked at keeping intrusive state authorities out of local affairs, and they've defended the rights of local communities to run things for themselves, called the Fengjian tradition in reform discourse. And Fengjian literally means feudal. And in arguing for a revival of the Fengjian tradition, as reformers have in China through the centuries, they're not arguing for a feudalism, but they're arguing for local autonomy and a local self-government that is not separate from state powers, that are separate from the state structures, but are in dialogue and in negotiation with the state structure. In other words, it's not a feudal system in the European sense of the word. Every time, you could say with the cycles of imperial despotism, with the rise of despotism as occurred periodically through imperial history, we see concomitantly a reassertion of this Fengjian tradition. It occurred in the 19th century, the mid-19th century. Reformers in the 1860s began to call for less state interference in local affairs and to allow local people to run things for themselves. That movement gained more impetus by the 1890s as reformers felt that China's problems were becoming increasingly urgent. But in the early 20th century, this new drive to revive the Fengjian tradition ran up against the growing statism that was preoccupying reformers. In other words, the growing obsession with the need for a strong state in the face of foreign aggression. So in not just my argument, the people who study the history of local self-government argue that to some extent the attempt to reinstate the local self-government vision as a democratic vision was destroyed by the drive to increase the power of the state. In the 1930s, again, there were reformers who, railing against an intrusive state power, attempted to revive the ancient local self-government tradition. Leaping forward to the 1980s, I see the local self-government tradition alive and well in the current village self-government movement that took off in the mid-1980s. However, the context in the 1980s is radically different from pre-modern China. To begin with, modern communications makes an enormous difference to how groups are formed in local levels and how they communicate with other groups and with the state authority. Another critical factor is that people in grassroots organisations are now more educated, and to some extent the local self-government tradition has merged with the westernizing democracy tradition that insisted on the need for an educated populace before there could be a liberal democracy. So in other words, I'm arguing that what we see in the 20th century and into the 21st century is a conversation between the ancient traditions of democracy and the westernizers, the people who have committed to something like a liberal democracy. The drive for popular education was intrinsic to the arguments promoted by the liberal democrats, and what we now see in the village self-government movement is, as I said, a merging of those two traditions. So the point I'm trying to make is that I don't see a dichotomy, a dualism, or a conflict between ancient Chinese democracies and the westernizing thrust. The westernizers have molded and modified and accommodated a Western model to Chinese special circumstances. Similarly, the ancient traditions have driven forward on the back of a modernization that in fact transforms the local self-government tradition, but at the same time retaining its essential democratic thrust.
Given the argument put forward by Professor Sonny Low, he's with the Hong Kong Institute of Education and the Greater China Studies, the Center for Greater China Studies, he has argued that these Western democratization efforts in China or elsewhere, especially those that have been pushed by, let's say, the USA or Eurocentric powers, he says that they resulted in failure due to a poor understanding of democracy. And so by way of that, I'm wondering, could there be any part of these Western pushed democratization efforts that were taken, as you said, by the Chinese democratizationists, if we could call them that, could there be any part of that that's a mistake?
Well, there's a good point to that. And for example, and again, as an historian, I'm going to talk about history, that you could see that in 1911, 1912, yes, it was a mistake for Sun Yat-sen and his colleagues to try and impose a Western-style republic on China. However, a closer look at the 1911 revolution bears out points that I've been making. The main force behind the 1911 revolution can be said to be the push for constitutional monarchy. The by far the broad base of elite opinion was for constitutionalism and the rule of law. And those two themes have deep roots in Chinese traditions. And here I'm leaning on Theodore DeBarry's argument, whose numerous publications explore the theme of constitutionalism in going back 1,000 years, and also the reforming push for the rule of law as opposed to dynastic law. That those old ancient themes of constitutional restraints on imperial power and the rule of law gathered momentum as the Manchu dynasty was collapsing at the end of the 19th and into the early 20th century. And probably China's most spectacular moment of democracy were the elections, the nationwide elections for provincial assemblies in 1908-1909. It was really the dissatisfaction among the constitutional monarchs with the slow pace of imperial-sponsored change that led to the 1911 revolution. And then the paradox is that why, when the mainstream opinion was in favour of a constitutional monarchy, was in fact the monarchy overthrown in 1911-1912 mm-hmm. and replaced with a republic. The republic didn't work. The republic was a wrong idea for the time. The people who called themselves Republican Democrats, I would suggest, did have a misunderstanding of Western republicanism, and nor did they have much idea how to make it work in the context of early 20th century China. So that is an example of where the somewhat naive Westernizers prevailed over a movement that in fact had roots in indigenous traditions of democracy. It was an attempt to impose a Western model in the context of a perfectly viable and workable Chinese model. And why precisely that happened at that particular juncture of history, 1911-1912, is a complex question that I'm sure you don't want me to go into at this point. But that's one example. Then a second example is when the nationalists, the Kuomintang, did get their chance to, in fact, construct a republican system and rule as a democratic government in 1927. Sun Yat-sen had died, and Chiang Kai-shek was by now the paramount leader. And when he, in fact, formed a national government in 1927-28, he pointed to Sun Yat-sen's proposal that there be three stages by which democracy could be achieved in China. First, there was need for military reunification, which had more or less been achieved with the defeat of warlordism in 27-28. Then political tutelage, where the people be taught how to be democratic. And that required a period of dictatorship. And then that would be followed by nationwide elections and the forming of a national parliament and the introduction of a Western-style democracy. Now, Sun Yat-sen had described a period of political tutelage for, say, 5 or 6 years. Under Chiang Kai-shek, it lasted until 1948. And it was only when he faced defeat at the hands of the communists that he hurriedly announced measures for national elections and the election of a parliament. So here again is a government proclaiming to be committed to democracy and Sun Yat-sen's second principle of the people, and yet basically using the language of Western democracy without having really any commitment to its substance, or you might add a misunderstanding of its substance. So again, these are two failed attempts to impose an inadequately thought out system that borrowed very heavily from the West. And didn't take account of an indigenous tradition that that provided a foundation for a Chinese-style democracy. And then one more example: the democracy movement, as such, has really ever since 1911 been in opposition, and that applies particularly today. Since in the post-Mao era, the people who are defined as belonging to the democracy movement, many of them continue to make appeals to Western liberal democracy, to the liberal democratic model, and that has served to infuriate the Beijing government, which instinctively sees any talk of liberal democracy as interference by Western powers in Chinese affairs. And the people like Liu Xiaobo, the Nobel Prize winner, as agents of Western imperialism, if you like. So that there are many Democrats in China today who are clever enough to know that the language of Western democracy is in fact doing more harm than good, and veil, if you like, their push for democracy, or attempt to conceal what might look like Western origins. So, in other words, the story of Western democracy in China is a sorry story. It's a story of failure, and it remains the case today.
I'm rather interested to explore the other side of the argument. So here we've had a story of a failure. We've had, for example, in the early 20th century, when we had the rise of Chiang Kai-shek and so on, and that really almost totalitarian top-down approach. So we must have military control. We must have to teach you about democracy. And then we must build the institutions, and then you can have it. That sounds to me like quite a few dictators in Latin America, yes, or Africa.
Yes.
But is it possible to have something of a qualitative good that came out of the, if we could call it, imposition of Western, again, quote-unquote, democratic models in China?
Well, I find it hard to find any qualitative good, as in my understanding, the only times that Western democracy got close to the centres of power were in 1911-1912, again under the Kuomintang in 1927, where in fact many members of the Kuomintang were committed Democrats and were a product of the westernizing democratic tradition that Andrew Nathan focuses on almost exclusively. Mm. And then in the arguments of the post-Mao reformers, Wei Jingsheng's, for example, fifth modernization is unashamedly and very explicitly a call for the end of the one-party system, the establishment of a multi-party state, and the end of the Communist Party's monopoly of rule. And he uses the language of Western democracy in making that argument. But then he was in prison for 14 years and is now in exile in the United States. And that's the fate of any people in the post-Mao era who have attempted to impose the Western democratic model. A point I wanted to make, I'm not sure if this fits in here, but I said that I talk about, I've defined democracy in terms of popular sovereignty and with a focus on the non-government grassroots group formation and networking. That was really the system that was being developed in the 1900s, the first decade of the 20th century, by the mainstream reform movement that were not intent on overthrowing the monarchy and were not committed to a multi-party state, but were driving a democracy that had its roots in the local self-government movement. As I indicated before, that was overwhelmed by statism and state strengthening. But the elections that were held in 1908-1909 were in fact built on an idea of building democracy from the bottom up. It's just the problem was that the so-called grassroots organisations that were developed in that context were in fact very undemocratic. They were not agencies through which the people had a voice. Sun Yat-sen had that same Chinese vision, as well as being a westerniser and a proponent of Western republicanism. He was also very Chinese, and in most cases of the reformers of this era, that there was that duality, solid roots in China's good soil, at the same time as influenced by Western ideas. He also imagined a process of democratization from the bottom up, by building grassroots cells. He described Chinese society at the time as like a pile of loose sand, and that for those grains of sand to cohere, there needed to be organisation building beginning at the village, and the forming of solidarities at that level, and then moving progressively up through the different layers of administration, where again the fundamental principle was democracy, self-determination, self-government, but the self-government units forming networks and ultimately reaching up through a system of people assemblies, popular assemblies, through the county, the district, the prefecture, the province, and then ultimately the centre. That vision was never enacted under Chiang Kai-shek. He was just committed to political tutelage. The village self-government movement that started in 1980s, to some extent also, is built on that ancient vision of local self-government, of a means by which the people have a voice by the building of grassroots organisations that are progressively developed through a series of administrations and reaching up to the centre. So, in a way, we see more evidence of progress in that old local self-government ideal than we see in any attempt to set up a political system by instituting nationwide elections and forming a national parliament by administrative fiat from the top. So the attempts to do that have been feeble, frail, and failed. At the same time, has been a broken but still, if you like, steady commitment to the bottom-up approach. In fact, I'm captured by this idea is after the 1989 crackdown on the democracy movement, the Gate of Heavenly Peace documentary interviews a number of key actors, and one of the people was a journalist, a party member who in the 1980s became enthralled with democracy, democratisation, and was through his journalism was arguing for the political freedoms promised by democracy. After the crackdown, he expressed his deep disappointment in what he described as the elite attempt to build democracy from the top down, and that he saw the only hope for democracy in China in starting at the grassroots and the building of grassroots organisations at village level, and that from there on he was committing himself to the village self-government movement. So my emphasis on the village self-government movement is by no means original. It's an argument that is being made by a number of Chinese Democrats.
But still an exceedingly important one.
Yes.
Now that we've gotten this very vivid picture of grassroots, of that more successful effort, I suppose, for democratization in China, going with the grassroots, I mean, to me personally, that kind of seems like the norm, the rule, that for democracy to happen, it has to be based in dialects, in dialectics, in the dialogics of different groups in any given citizenry. So that bottom-up approach really resonates well with me. And I also see that perhaps it took this exercise with Western powers and the imposition of these Western conceptions to show in China that contrast, that it is the Chinese bottom-up approach that has the best chances of working. Now that we have come to see that China has its own unique forms of democracy, forms that are substantively different from Western ones, what does this mean for the politics of China?
I find that hard to answer. I've just been reading a very depressing piece about the crackdowns that have been occurring this year and earlier. One explanation being that, or the question that is being asked, this is a piece in Current History, it's asking why does the current regime feel so insecure? The vision of people like Liu Bingyang, who again was an activist in the 80s and ended up in exile, he believed that democracy could be achieved in a one-party state and could be achieved by the Communist Party, and he put his faith in the evident pluralism within the Communist Party, and had faith in the Communist Party being willing to accept pluralism and diversity within the party. And so I suppose the alternatives are the party leadership becoming comfortable with plurality, with pluralism, or in fact the collapse of the one party state. Then there are the arguments that Chinese society has become so diversified, so plural, that ultimately the system is going to crack. I'm not really qualified to engage in speculation and guessing. A lot of people are doing this, mm-hmm. and I think that what I'll say is that the Chinese people who are making the argument that I'm making and on whom I lean very heavily do believe that democratization under the Communist Party is possible, that it does require a Communist Party leadership that is more relaxed with diversity and willing to let people speak discordantly and accommodate a discord of multiple voices. So yes, there are people who are deeply committed to that idea, and indeed my friends and colleagues I have who are closer to the scene than I am and to engage with Chinese intellectuals make a big issue of how much is going on behind the scenes, and that those people behind the scenes are perfectly happy to keep things behind the veil, because in that way they can get on with what they're doing rather than ending up in jail. Mm-hmm. So the the new party leadership will be in place by next year, and there are people who hope that the current tension and nervousness at the top will be resolved once a new leadership team is in place. But let's wait and see.
Finally, how does this realization that China has a diversity of endogenous democratic types, let's say they might vary from region to region, affect the epistemology of democracy? Where do we, as an academy, go from here with your work?
Well, I suggest that the collection of essays in The Secret History are pointing the way forward, they challenge the hegemony of the Western liberal model, and they also make the argument that rather than a standardization of democratic forms and systems, that there are multiple ways through which the fundamental principles of democracy, that is, of equality, of self-determination, the freedom to speak your mind, and the access to agencies of political power, that can be achieved in different ways, in different contexts, and that it's the onus is on the academy, on scholars, to examine, to explore, to search in those different contexts. There's one early Chinese democrat in the Western tradition, Yan Fu, at the end of the 19th century. The earliest of the westernizing reformers in the 1860s formulated or used an ancient Chinese binary, the so-called Ti-Yung dichotomy, Ti meaning essence and Yung meaning utility or tools. And they argued that that there was a Chinese essence that had to be retained, but while preserving that Chinese essence, it was okay to use Western tools, that is, Western technology. By the end of the century, Yan Fu, remembered as a democrat in the Western tradition, reformulated that binary. And he argued that what was essential, that what was immutable and could not be changed, was freedom. And that the Jung side of the dichotomy, the tools, was democracy. So that, in other words, the tools for democracy, the tools for achieving freedom, can be different in different contexts. That the constant, the immutable, is the principle, the ideal of freedom as the foundation of a civilized society. And so I think what we need to do is explore the different means, the different tools for achieving the fundamental principles that are at the heart of the way I define democracy.
Absolutely fascinating. Dr. Pauline Keating, thank you so very much for gracing us with your time.
Thank you, Jean-Paul. It's been a pleasure.